This week, we start off our passage in the continuation of Luke in chapter 3, and it says in his very first year, Luke introduces the scene as the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate being governor of Judea, and Herod being tetrarch of Galilee, and his brother Philip tetrarch of the region of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Lysanias tetrarch of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, which is a lot of names, and it's really easy to read through this and not think a whole lot about it, but this is quite the introduction, quite the political and social setting to set, because if you're familiar, I'm not terribly, but if you're familiar with Game of Thrones and the drama that ensued there, this period of history made Game of Thrones look like children's books. For example, Tiberius Caesar, during his reign, it's said that not a day passed in his rule without an execution ordered by him. And when there is an ancient tradition in Rome that virgins could not be executed, and so he had the executioners make sure they weren't virgins before they were executed. He also, as a tyrant himself, allowed and encouraged the tyranny of regional rulers to do much of what they saw fit, especially to non-Roman citizens. Then there was the taxation that they levied upon the people that were around them, right? So taxation, Romans taxed everyone that they conquered, and they farmed out this process of taxing them to the highest bidder. So regional governors, regional whoever could bid the highest and say, I can collect the most amount of money, got awarded the contracts. And of course, they charged their own commission. So you have the Roman tax, and you have the commission taxed by the people who were collecting the tax, and then you have the people that they were employing called the tax collectors, who not only collected the tax, but they also were authorized by the Romans to collect as much as they wanted. And if anyone objected to it, well, too bad, the Romans are in charge. So this led to exorbitant tax rates, upwards of over 50% in some cases of wages, which is really hard to consider. And then, not only that, but then if you were a non-Roman citizen, you had very few rights to anything, least of all justice. Roman rulers and the army could basically do what they pleased in the name of keeping the peace. This is the situation to which John the Baptist comes into the scene and starts his ministry, and soon to be Jesus as well. The people of Israel were crying out for a savior, eagerly anticipating someone who would overthrow Roman rule, because life was awful underneath their thumb. And it's in this situation that John the Baptist, that Jesus would come on. And as these people are crying out and desiring and wanting a savior, that God prepares us for his son. Not in the expectations maybe of what the Israelites thought, maybe not often in the expectations of what we think a savior should be like and in doing, but in the way that we need the savior, that only God could perceive, that only God could see that we really truly needed to be saved. And so God prepares us for a son. So let's dig into that. What does that mean? How does God prepare us for the Messiah that we may not think that we want in the way that he came, with the one in which we so desperately need? All right, let's read. Let's dig in. Let's continue on in our scripture for today in chapter 3, picking up there at the end of verse 2. So in the midst of this social and political scene, the word of God came to John, the son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. And he went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. As it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be made low. The crooked shall become straight, the rough places shall become level ways, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God. Therefore he, that is John, said therefore to the crowds who came out to be baptized to him, you brood of vipers! What a very winsome way to win people over to Jesus, by the way, calling them all broods of vipers. Who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruits in keeping with repentance. And do not begin to say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our father, for I tell you, God is able from these very stones to raise up children for Abraham. Even now the axe is laid to the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. And the crowds asked him, what then shall we do? And he answered them, whoever has two tunics is to share with him who has none. Now that sounds like an easy thing to do, right? If I've got an extra shirt, if I've got an extra coat, share it with somebody who doesn't have one. But a tunic back in these days, as far as we're able to tell, would cost about the equivalent of $5,000, right? It was about a month's wages worth. So maybe a modern day application that would be to say, hey, if you've got two cars, share with one who doesn't have one. A little bit, hits a little bit different when that's the application. And whoever has food is to do likewise. Tax collectors also came to be baptized and said to him, teacher, what shall we do? Right? Remember, these are the tax collectors we're talking about. And he said to them, collect no more than you are authorized to do. Pretty common sense there. Soldiers also asked him, and we, what shall we do? And he said to them, do not extort money from anyone by threats or by false accusation, and be content with your wages. Again, for a guy out in the wilderness that we read off is dressed in camel hair and is seen by many as a ranting and raving lunatic, the things that he's telling them to do is pretty reasonable. God calls us to repentance. That's what John's message is here, the message of come and repent and bear the fruits of repentance. And so in God's way, as he prepares us for his son, we see this first and foremost in the message of John to repent, to make ready, to be ready, to prepare ourselves for him. If you look with me there in verses 2-4, John is proclaiming God's word, which is a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And why would people go out to see him? I mean, you think of today, you think of some of the preachers that we have around here that honestly can often sound like they're off their rocker, right? John very similarly would have been seen back in those days. And yet crowds went to go see him. They wanted to hear him. They wanted to see and hear his message. And he welcomes them with this call of you brood of vipers who warned you to come out here. Why are they going to see them? Well, as we highlighted at the beginning, because they are desperate for God to act. They know in their own lives that we need salvation. Their life was so hard that they knew that they needed God himself to be acting in their lives. Which is an interesting question for us to ponder and consider, because for the most part, our lives don't look like the ancient Israelites. We don't have to go through many of the things that they had to go through in the tyranny of a ruler like Tiberius Caesar. And yet, as we think about it, there's many ways, many areas in our lives that, man, we have been trying and trying and trying to make things get better, to make things go back to the way that they should be, or to come back to the way that we hoped that they would be, and yet they've persisted, and yet the relationships may still be broken, and yet there's a habit, a sin that we just can't seem to get out of. Maybe we feel like we've woven ourselves into it through a pattern of lies or through a pattern of deception, and it doesn't seem like there's any way out of it that is agreeable. The only way out might be through divine intervention. Because on the surface here, life in America is pretty easy, pretty great. It can be, at least this is the message that we get, that there really isn't necessarily a need for a savior. It's just a matter of working, of going through therapy, of going and doing something, and we can pull ourselves up. And yet, as we examine ourselves deeply, as we examine the things that we've done, the ways in which we've hurt the people around us, and the ways in which we've been hurt by the people around us, and the need for relationships to be reconciled, man, these are just the touch points, the tip of the iceberg of the ways in which we need God, because we have shown by our own actions that we're unable to do it ourselves. We're unable to save ourselves. And so what does it look like to get ready for God? What does it get ready to be ready for God to be acting in our lives and to be redeeming these parts of our lives that seem unsavable? Well, that first part, right? That first part as described by John is just to recognize our own sin, to recognize how we're contributing to the problem in our lives, and to repent, to say, I'm sorry, I don't want to do this. God, help me not to do this. A while ago when I was shopping for a used car, I found a car on the internet that looked great, and so I went and I saw it and I inspected it. It looked good from the outside. It didn't have any dents or dings. This paint was in good condition. It didn't see much rust or anything like that. And so I took it for a test drive, brought it to a mechanic, and he put it up on a lift, and about 30 seconds later from looking at it, he turned to me and he said, this car isn't worth $500. There was so much wrong on the inside. The oil was burning. The transmission was shot. This car wasn't going to last much longer on its own. It was about to implode pretty much. He said it wasn't really safe to even drive it off of the lot. And it looked nice from the outside, right? But once you looked on the inside, it was like, oh, man, that's when you began to see things falling apart. Because here's the thing about God's Son. Here's the thing about John's message here is that even though he is the King of Kings, the ruler of rulers, right? And if we were to have the Queen of England come to our town, our church, there would be much fanfare. There would be rolling out of the red carpet. There would be incredible preparations for royalty. But Jesus, even though he is the King of Kings, does not care about how things look on the outside. What he cares about is what's going on the inside. Where are our hearts at? Where are our thoughts at? Because just like that car couldn't fix itself, right? That car that I brought to the mechanic couldn't fix itself. So the entire story of the Old Testament, the entire story of Israel shows that we are unable to fix ourselves. We are unable to bear the fruit of repentance that John calls for the people to do by our own effort because we try. And yet the world still is as it is. And so what can we do? If we're called to repent of our sins, right? If we're called to repent of all of the ways that we've contributed to the messed up things in the world. And yet, as the Old Testament shows, as we've seen through the story of our own lives, that we aren't able to fix it by ourselves. What then can we do? Well, then we turn to God because he's the one preparing us. And we see and we find that God enables us through the power of the Holy Spirit so that we aren't relying upon our own action, but he is the one working through us and doing it and affecting the action and the change that he wants to see in us. If we keep reading in chapter 3 and starting in verse 15, we see this. As the people were in expectation and all were questioning in their hearts concerning John, whether he might be the Christ, the Messiah, the one that they're longing for, John answered them all saying, I baptize you with water. But he who is mightier than I is coming, the strap of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into the barn, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire. And so with many other exhortations, he preached good news to the people. It's a bit interesting if you look at what we just read, that they were calling that the good news. That's pretty terrifying. But Herod the Tetrarch, who had been reproved by him for Herodias, his brother's wife, whom he married. Did I say things were messed up that day? Because they were. And for all the evil things that Herod had done, added this to them all, that he locked up John in his prison because he didn't want his own sin being exposed, called out. Interesting. Now when all the people were baptized, and when Jesus had also been baptized and was praying, the heavens were opened, and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove, and a voice came from heaven, you are my beloved Son, and with you I am well pleased. Look with me there in verse 16. John baptizes with water, but Jesus baptizes with the Holy Spirit. Because what does John's baptism really do? What is this thing that all of the people of Israel were going out and they were doing? They were being dunked in water for the repentance and the forgiveness of their sins. honestly, his baptism didn't do anything. It was merely symbolic. It was a ritual. It was something to do. It was something as an outward sign of saying you need to be acknowledging that you need repentance, acknowledging that things need to change. Because the heart posture is what was really important. That's what John was really after. That's what he was saying. This is what was really needed. And if dunking you in water, right, and if this declaration is what's going to help you do that, then so be it. Let's do this. Let's call this and have an outward showing of things need to be cleansed. But let me tell you, John says, let me tell you that I'm just doing this with water, but Jesus who is coming, he will do this with the Holy Spirit. And when you are baptized with Jesus by the Holy Spirit, you come out a new person, changed, empowered by him, so that God himself is working in you and through you. No longer do we have to go through life by ourselves, but God himself will be working in our hearts to change them, to make them into what God desires for us to be, to help us so that as we live here on earth, though we won't be perfect, right? Sin will always be here until Jesus comes again. But as we live here on earth, so we can, through the power of God, help creation to flourish more in the way that God desired for it to be. So that people will see, right, as we proclaim this, people will see that where Jesus goes, where the Holy Spirit goes, so comes a flourishing that can only be found through God's action. Now, back in our passage for today, Jesus' ministry was just starting. In fact, we just got to the very beginning of it at the end of the passage in which Jesus had been baptized and the Holy Spirit comes down on him like an ordination, like a coronation, like God saying, okay, Jesus, now it is time for your ministry to begin. He'd always been Jesus. He'd always had this ministry. He's always been having this ministry, but now the public proclamation has been started. Just like in a couple weeks, we're going to ordain and install elders and deacons to our own church and consistory. So that's a similar thing that's happening here. The people that we're installing, the people we're going to be calling elders and deacons, they've always been acting in that way. That's why we've elected them. Because they've served as deacons, because they've served as elders. But now we're going to do so and say, you are doing so as in an active way, in a public way, proclaimed with the title. And that's what God was doing here to Jesus. Jesus had always been Jesus, but now from here on out in Luke, his ministry to the public has begun. God has prepared his people. Luke has prepared his reader, Theophilus, in here. He said, Jesus, right, Jesus is the Messiah. He is the Son of God. And now John is getting the people ready, and I am telling you what it means to be ready, Theophilus, for God to work in yourself, because God, Jesus' ministry has come. And we have the honor and the privilege today of living after Jesus has completed his ministry here on earth. After, as we're about to read throughout here, after he's given the teachings and he's brought up disciples and he's created and nourished a church in which we get to be a part of and a community of believers that we get to share in and do life with and to care for one another and to love for one another. And maybe, not maybe, but even more so, even far greater than that, even after Jesus has already sacrificed himself on our behalf so that we might be saved. And as he rose to life again, so also he gives us new life again through the power of the Holy Spirit. So that as we live now, right, as we live now, we know that life here on earth is not the end of the story. This is not the end all be all. What we experience here, thankfully, is not as good as it's going to get. In fact, everything we experience here is nothing compared to what we will experience in heaven. The best vacations, the best food, the best of times with each other, these are a dim reflection of what life will be like in God's presence when Jesus comes again. And so, Christ Church, this is the challenge that John has for us, has for the people of Israel, and we hear it again today. As God is preparing us for his Son, as God has prepared us for his Son, he has called us into repentance. Called us to examine ourselves. And honestly, that call of repentance is pretty reasonable. If you're extorting people, don't. If you're oppressing your people. Stop. Right? If you see someone else who is in need, help. They're simple, reasonable commands, but man, are they so hard to do. And there's so many reasons, because sin has its grip so tightly on this world and on society and in the ways in which we interact each other. We need a Savior to help us to be able to do that. And thankfully, we have one. His name is Jesus. Amen. Let's pray. Dear Lord, God, get us ready for Jesus. Get us ready for the Holy Spirit to be working in our lives. And Lord, as you pour out, as you work in and amongst our community, help us to do what you call us to do. Assure us that you love us. Assure us that we don't need to lie, to steal, to deceive, to fight, to cheat in order to get ahead in this world, because what happens here, Lord, is only important so far as what is coming and getting everyone ready and declaring your good news and loving people and letting them know the light of your gospel, of your Son, of Jesus. So Father, help us to do so. Help us to love our neighbors. Help us when it's hard, when it means sacrificing some of our own enjoyment, our own pleasure, to do so, so that those who are around us may know your love. Father, we pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. All right, Christ Church, just as God calls us to himself, so also he gives us a reminder of what he's done. And he does that through the table, through the eating of bread and the drinking of wine or of grape juice that we use, the gathering together of those grapes, that just as the grains from many hills are gathered together into one loaf, so God's people are gathered together from many nations into one body. And just as these grapes have been used and have been formed into a new substance, into a liquid, into a wine or a grape juice, whatever it might be, and something that is pleasing to drink, so God forms his people into something that is good and pleasing to him, and that it goes out into the world and proclaims his message. And he does so through the work of Jesus, through the power of the Holy Spirit. Christ Church, on the night that he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread and he broke it, saying, "This is my body, broken on your behalf. Take and eat in remembrance of me." And in the same manner, he took the cup, and after they had supped, he poured it out, saying, "This is my blood poured out on your behalf as a New Testament. Take and drink in remembrance of me." If you're here in the seats, you'll have the individual cups that we're using because of the continuing safety measures. There's two flaps, one to release the wafer, one to release the juice. If you're at home, we invite you to join with us in eating and drinking whatever you may have on hand. Let this end.